Yeah. Professor Rishi. So we will start in a minute or two. People are on coming in. So how is the weather back home in Japan, Japan?
Yeah, it's still it's a spring time, but very hot today.
Oh, okay.
Yes, it's an almost summer.
Okay.
Yes.
So, here, of course, we are in the middle of it.
Yes. Yeah, and but the rainy season will start next month. So now it's not so humid, not so bad season.
Right. So our in our system, the monsoon should start another 2 weeks towards the end of the month. Monsoon will be on us. How is the weather there, Dr. Namrata?
Yeah, I was wondering. I think I'm the one who should be telling about what summer really means. We are looking at 44 degrees right now, 110 Fahrenheit, daytime. Yeah, so very hot is all I can say. Hopefully, here after some time, it'll get less hot, but just humid. It doesn't rain very much here. So yeah, I guess it's just have to wait it out until winter.
We in Bangalore, we are somewhere in between. Today it is 34 degrees between Japan and North. Great. Thank you both for joining this session. So I think we are on time. Let us start the session. So ladies and gentlemen, good evening for to those who are in India, and good morning for those who have joined us from US and Europe. My name is Saidi Pratnam. I'm the Chief Operating Officer MIJST at IIMD. Mizuho India Japan Study Center is a center of excellence at IIM Bangalore. And we are very pleased to welcome you all to this third panel presentation and overall the 21st webinar series. This is called the Meijin Sanwad or Expert Conversation. This is a discussion series that we started sometime in August of 2020, almost at the peak of wave one of COVID. We select a topic with a group of panelists, both from India, Japan, rest of the world, who will share their perspective on a particular topic with our audience. The panel typically there are experts in this field who share facts, opinions, and also high quality of information and insight into the field of which you are studying. This we have found that would benefit our audience extremely well. But before going into the discussion, let me just give you a brief intro about our center. As I said, MIJST, our center of excellence, serves as a facilitator for many collaborative initiatives among the academia, industry, government agencies of both. And the focus of the center has been to strengthen India and Japan bond by promising academic, promising a greater connect between academic institutions, industry, and of course, societal and policy. On our today's presentation, panel discussion, the title is Global Warming is No Myth, Urban Water Crisis Management Strategy of India. In this webinar, our panel first will discuss approaches that would help India and Japan to address the challenges by providing safe, reliable, as well as sustainable water system to a very rapidly growing urban population, especially in India, but to some extent, lesser extent, Japan. Our panelists will talk about the efforts made by both the countries to address common problems such as droughts and floods, strategies that have been implemented to meet the challenges of rapid urbanization and, of course, population growth. They will also share their insight on how water infrastructure and consumption can be improved using technology and mindset change. And finally, we will also discuss how cities can be better prepared to meet the risks that are associated with climate change, because these changes could lead to, as we discussed earlier, floods as well as droughts across the country and across the world. So let me have the great pleasure to introduce the two panelists today. Dr. Mikio Ishiwatari, he is a visiting professor, University of Tokyo, senior advisor, Japan International Cooperative Agency, or JICA, as it is called. And he is in the board of Japan Water Forum. The other panelist, Professor Namrata Kindarkar, he is a chair and associate professor at the JSW School of Public Policy at IIM Ahmedabad. Let me give a brief, I won't say CV, but a brief intro to each of these two eminently qualified panelists today. Dr. Ishiwatari has been engaged in projects and research work on basically disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation. He has led the formulation of the Japanese assistance policy of climate change adaptation and community-based disaster management. He has worked in the World Bank as senior disaster risk management specialist and has produced a wonderful book, Learning from Mega Disasters and Lessons from the Great East Japan Earthquake. So I think it is a must read for those who want to understand how to mitigate the effects of a sudden crisis. He has worked at the Ministry of Land, Infrastructure and Transport in Japan. And he was responsible for formulating and supervising the national project of flood risk management in Japan. He was also responsible for R&D as a senior director, deputy director for river technology and information Japan. And I could go on and on about his accomplishments, which are very long. But I would wrap it up with more recent role as urban development specialist at the ADB or Asian Development Bank. He's a member of the committee on building resilience to natural disasters, which Japan Science Society. Then he's a member of the Advisory Council of Development Assistance, as I mentioned earlier. He's also in the steering committee of water and climate change of Asia Pacific Water Forum, and many, many other committees, both governmental and non-governmental organizations. Just to wrap up, he's a PhD in international studies and MSc in urban engineering from University of Tokyo. The other panelist, equally well accomplished, Namrata Darshan, apart from being the chair and associate professor at IIM Ahmedabad, he's also a fellow of the Initiative for Sustainable Energy. It is called ISC, I think, at the John Hopkins School of Advanced Science Studies. Yes. Previously, she was an associate assistant professor. She worked in Singapore at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy under NUS in Singapore. And he was also a faculty associate at the Institute of Water Policy at Singapore, NUS. Professor Namrata has received a PhD in International Development Policy from the School of Public Policy at the University of Maryland, USA. Her research has always been focusing on sustainable development and social policy. And with the current emphasis on her research emphasis is on access to basic infra availability like energy, water, sanitation, so on. Individual and household welfare, inequality, food security, then subjective well-being, as well as gender overall development. So her methodological approach is basically applied econometrics and policy impact evaluation, and utilizing primary, secondary, and administrative policy data for all her people. So we are indeed very lucky to have such a panel of experts to talk on the theme of today, which is to reiterate, global warming is no myth, urban water crisis management strategy of both India and China. So may I now request Dr. Ishivatari to make a short presentation, which will set the context for further discussion, especially bringing in the Japanese perspective. Over to you, Dr. Ishi.
Yeah, thank you very much, Sadeep-san. Thank you so much for introduction. Okay, and thank you very much for inviting me to this webinar. I'm very happy to speak and discuss this important issue with participants. Okay, let's start my presentation. Yes, my topic is managing water resources in urban areas in Japan. And I will introduce some Japanese experience around for some 15 minutes. And my key message is Japan has resolved various water issues in urban areas through structural or non-structural measures. Well, of course, we are still struggling some issues, in particular impacted by climate change. Okay. First, I would introduce what's the issues. What's the issues? What were issues in Japan? So this is a migration from rural areas to metropolitan areas. In particular, in 1960s, 400,000 or 600,000 people every year is coming to Tokyo, Osaka, or Nagoya metropolitan areas. Well, currently, as you know, Japanese population is decreasing, so migration is become smaller. So, but in 1960s and 70s, during high economic growth period, urbanization was a rapid population increase, was a very crucial issue for Japan. How to provide public services for like housings, water, or transport, et cetera. It's a key issue during this period for the government. And so it was a very rapid urbanization. This is in Tokyo metropolitan area. You can compare with between 1960s and 1995. A black line is a railway. So as you can understand, urbanization was progressed along such a railways in Tokyo. And issues, I don't want to explain each box, it's so complicated. And as anyone can understand, it's a very complicated and confusing and processes. Urban development, population increase, lifestyle change, industrial structure change are affecting such sort of a cascading impacts, flooding, landslides, heat, pollution, drought, ecosystem, et cetera, already introduced. And okay, so let's see one by one. For pollution. Well, Japanese government did not regulate so well. That's why in Japan, during this 1960s, or in particular 1950s or 60s, ocean, bay, rivers were very polluted. Well, currently it's okay, but water is always black, or in this case, colored, or smell, and very dirty. I think this is the most severe situation. Pollution diseases happened. Famous one is a Minamata disease. This is a mercury affecting human health. So one factory in Minamata City discharged mercury and causing some contamination for fish and people eat. Legally certificated patients are some 3,000 and medical support provided for 38,000 people. As you can understand, it's a very huge scale of health damage for people. And from houses, water is discharged. This is a Tokyo area. And drought. Yeah, as the first Olympic in Tokyo, not the latest one, Tokyo Olympic was organized in 1964. At that time, drought happened. So we call it Olympic drought. And the next issue is land subsidence, land sinking. You can see this is a Tokyo area, a river level and land level. You can see land level is quite low. Because of groundwater usage, in some area, land sank by 4 meters. Because of groundwater usage for factories. And still now, in Tokyo area, we call zero meter area, it meaning below sea level. So 20% of Tokyo downtown, 1.5 million people live in such a lowland area, I mean lower than sea level. It's a risk area for high tide and flooding. And flooding, well, this is just, not just 2018, where some part of Japan severely damaged by heavy rainfall. At the time, total over 200 people died across the country. So from a developed a high growth period in 1950s till now, still we are struggling, fighting against flooding. Okay, so what's a countermeasures? And actually it's quite complicated again because local government, Japanese government took various measures and they still are taking various measures. So I would try to explain some clearly. And the first one is how to manage demand of water use. A very typical tariff system is discouraging water usage, meaning if we use more water, unit cost, unit price is increasing. So this is a discouraging system. And another one is supply side. So improving leakage. Currently, Japanese leakage water system is quite low. In Tokyo, it's only 3%. It's a quite low level comparing with other countries or other cities. But it was 80% in 1945. So Japanese government, in particular Tokyo Metropolitan Government, they tried to improve leakage situation and now succeeded to lower such a leakage ratio. Another major is rainwater harvesting and recycling. You can see now such a recycling, rainwater harvesting is this one, purple one, and the factory, they are recycling water and the sewerage system. After treated at sewerage treatment plant, such water is used again. Currently, total volume is 270 million cubic meter. This is a large scale dam reservoir's capacity, almost same. So this means that Japanese society or facilities are saving water, and it's a saving volume is a so quite huge number. And let's see some one by one. It is at house level. So yeah, from a roof, rainwater is collected. And this is used for car washing or watering greenery or using for toilet. Well, I think this system is used in India, your countries also. And maybe difference is local government. Some local governments have some subsidy system, financial assistance system to individual houses. So they say it's a small dams in town. And not only for ordinary life, it's used for emergency, like a fire or disaster earthquake time, water supply stopped, but this water can be used for such an emergency situation. And some bigger facilities. This is a Tokyo Dome, we call. It's a Yomiuri Giants baseball stadium. And last weekend, I went there to watch baseball game. Anyway, so this is a dome. So from dome, they are collecting rainfall. And this water is filtered and clean and used for, again, for toilet or some other purposes. And it's good for firefighting also. And more bigger scale, district level. After cleaning, after treated sewerage water, this water is used for buildings in Shinjuku. Shinjuku is a big leading business district in Tokyo. There are many high buildings. And the high-story buildings are using such water treated as the treatment plant. And Japanese technology is used for such a treatment, membrane treatment. Japanese companies are leading this area, so such technology is used for such a recycling or rainwater harvesting. Okay, groundwater management. I understand that groundwater management is a crucial issue in India also. And in Japan, it's a crucial issue for urban area because industrial factories they used, it's cheap and clean. And how to manage it? In case of Japan, firstly, supply industrial water and subsidized because groundwater is very cheap. That's why without subsidized factory, they don't want to use it. That's why local government provided some financial support, also developed some water resources. And we have a unique system, water supply only for industry, not for households. And of course, our regulation, regulated some zone, and local governments, governors require permission, and big wells were prohibited. This is some mechanisms. Because of such a regulation or water resource development, you can see industrial water supply increased, meaning groundwater usage declining. And the factory, well, because there's not so much water resources in rivers or lake, that's why industrial companies, they echo water. So now ratio is 80%, and blue is intake. So intake volume still remains and not so increased. Instead, they are recycling water. For housing compound also, tried introducing some infiltration facilities or detention ponds, et cetera, because to revitalize or improve water cycle. So rainfall can be infiltrated into the groundwater instead of a run on surface. And that's why in this district, this compound, flood water can be decreased and discharge groundwater increased. Yeah, this is a scenery of the district. And the environmental improvement, yeah, as I said, this is Tokyo area, it was quite dirty, smelled black. But nowadays, if you go to Tokyo rivers, you can see very clean and you can see fish also. And of course, several system contributed such improvement. So this is several systems. Well, actually in 1970s, well, service ratio was not so high, but nowadays almost covered urban areas. And the unique measure is Jokaso, we say. Jokaso is this one. It's a very small scale treatment plant on site. So it's a very small, it's a size is almost a parking lot for a vehicle. So in rural area, this is very effective and efficient. And the performance is very good and almost same as a big treatment plant. So please understand, this is a small treatment plant on site. And because of this Jokaso system, in rural area also, they can treat or they can make clean water. So flood protection, next issue. We are combining some structure measures and non-structure measures. And the structure measures in Tokyo area, it's a little bit complicated and very difficult, very crowded, and land price is very expensive. So one approach is a joint project. It is a joint project between housing and flood protection. So they shared cost for construction and operation and maintenance. So housing company, this is a public company, public company constructed with Tokyo Metropolitan Government. So Tokyo Metropolitan Government shared cost for reserve. And this reserve can be used for like sports facilities at normal time. But once flooding happened, this area became a reserve and to reduce flood damage. And recently, green infrastructure or nature-oriented approach becoming catchy area. And Japan already started such a, we say, nature-oriented approach. It's good for preserve and create ecosystem. This is urban area in Fukuoka. Urban area, you can see a very wide rivers. If they construct these rivers by concrete, they can reduce capacity or areas. But instead, they used such a greenery. And it's good for kids. Elementary school use this river for their environmental program. And in some areas, it's cost effective. And even in downtown in Tokyo, this is this green infrastructure is very effective. Case of Futago Tamagawa, next to Tamagawa area. Here's our Rakuten headquarter and commercial building. Well, they try to, it's a very sustainable way development, environmental friendly, like a green roof, solar panels, et cetera, et cetera. In addition, this is a joint project again, such a commercial compound and parks. But you can see this is not an ordinary park. It's a sort of mound because this is protecting Futago Tamagawa downtown area from this Tamagawa big river. So this is a joint project, again, commercial compound and embankment and parks. Okay, so one program is urban poor. How to manage urban poor? This is a case in Hiroshima. We called it atomic bomb slum because affected people by bomb lived here along Otagawa River. They are victims and illegally occupied. So how to manage this one with flood project? Currently, it's a very clean and the downtown Hiroshima used for public facilities. So where are urban poor? The Hiroshima city government constructed affordable apartment, this white one, and it's a very low rent. And they moved here, and you can see beautiful embankments. So this is a joint program again, a river flood protection program and housing program for urban poor. Okay, so almost time. So I try to explain. So such a complicated programs because Japan did many things. Well, Japan still are doing many things. So what I use some measures I explained, groundwater, how to manage, and the environment, how to improve, and flood control. And you noticed, these are not only a one purpose, and it's always, not always, some of them are multi-purpose measures. So this is sort of a summary of recycling water cycle in Japan urban areas. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the wonderful overview of what you took us through the Japan's four urban challenges. So basically, industrial water pollution, water shortage, land subsistence, and flooding. And later on, you also set the tone for the countermeasures that, as you said, Japan has been taking or is taking regarding the four key elements, the water usage, groundwater, environmental, and also the flooding part. And you have explained all that in a very visually powerful manner. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I think we will explore some of these in our further discussion. So now may I request the other panelist, Professor Amrita, to give us an overview of the Indian perspective, India's endeavors in urban water crisis and also water management strategy that we have been following. Over to you, Professor Amrita.
Yes, thank you so much. And thank you, Dr. Ishii. I think really well set in terms of the tone of what we are here to discuss. I think I must also admit that this is going to be more text than what the previous presentation was. So I'm going to focus a lot on the policy angle and how exactly is India thinking about urban water crisis in terms of problematizing it, as well as what have been the policy responses so far. And it's very nice that Dr. Ishii already put out a couple of examples, which I had on my slides as well. So maybe we can open up a discussion around that after both the presentations are over. Just to put out a few numbers there, recent Government of India estimates say something like per capita availability of water is going to dip quite significantly from 1,486 cubic meters to 1,367 cubic meters. And that's going to happen fairly soon in less than a decade's time. There are also other recent estimates that have come out on urban water scarcity, which puts the number of urban residents in India facing water scarcity to be around 225 million. And then by 2050, it is expected that one quarter of the water-stressed population is projected to be concentrated in India, and the majority of them are expected to reside in urban areas. So I have tried to break down the problem facing India in terms of water crises into three. So these are, the problems which are most salient. So there is insufficiency of potable water. There is inadequate water for sanitation and also inadequate sewerage. And in recent years, urban flooding has also become a problem. Again, there are numbers which tell us that the problems are only increasing. Just in terms of insufficiency of drinking water, about 31% of the urban population is estimated to not have pipe water supply. And many cities, households in cities report that they receive intermittent water supply and on average 6 to 8 hours in a day. In terms of sanitation, 67.3% of the households, they report not being connected to a pipe sewage discharge system. So these again are coming from some of the more recent data that have been released. Although these data are still quite dated, but these are the most recent survey data that were put out. With regards to urban flooding, I think that is where the picture really is telling. Between 1985 to 2018, it is estimated that India's urban exposure to flooding expanded from 171 square kilometers to 3,745 square kilometers. So that's a huge, significant change in exposure to flooding and something which really needs to be highlighted. And a recent Niti Aayog, which is the think tank, government think tank, also reported that more and more cities are now reporting flooding due to heavy precipitation. And I'll come to what exactly are the factors driving these challenges. Again, I have tried to break them down into just infrastructure, policy capacity factors, and then what we all know. There is, of course, climate change at the back of the story. In terms of infrastructure and spatial planning, the biggest issue across urban India has been unplanned expansion. So while we are urbanizing, and it is an aspiration as well that India needs to be more and more urbanized and provide more opportunities, it is not happening in a very planned manner. which has meant that there is encroachment of wetlands. And as people sitting there in Bangalore would know, this is happening at a rapid pace in that city. And this is a similar story elsewhere as well. So there is migration and population growth, which all of us are aware of. And even the existing infrastructure that is there, it is of poor quality. So of course, it is not keeping pace with this agglomeration that is happening. And it is stuck in a low-level revenue equilibrium, meaning that because people cannot afford to pay for utilities, the utility companies themselves, many of which are actually just government-run, they are also stuck in this low-level revenue equilibrium. So they also cannot get enough revenue for their services, and therefore are, you know, turning out to be pretty financially unviable. Policy capacity issues. So for people in the audience who are not aware, so we have a tiered governance system. So which means that there could be a difference in the state government and the party which is running the municipal corporation or an urban local body. So there are elections at all levels. And a lot of the issues actually arise because there is lack of coordination between these levels. So while the water is a state subject, the municipal corporation could be a different government and then may not cooperate or may not agree with the viewpoint of the state government. And that causes a lot of issues. So there is a very deep political economy behind a lot of our water problems. More importantly, most of our municipal corporations are actually now become financially unviable. So they don't collect enough revenue through various sources. So we're not only saying through service provision, but also things such as property taxes and other sources from land revenue and so on. They are not performing as well and collecting sufficient revenue such that they're able to keep up with the infrastructure requirements and the service requirements. So that also keeps them in this low revenue, low service trap, and there are organizational and financial incapacities. Many Indian cities, in fact, have absolutely no stormwater management plan in place at all. That has simply not been a part of their planning exercise, which is extremely surprising. So not the bigger metropolitan cities, but a lot of the tier two, tier three cities, they don't take the stormwater management issue that seriously. And climate change is coming into the discussion only now, very, very recently. And I'll come to it also in just a bit. Again, the way we think of water crisis, whether it is urban or rural or agricultural, is very different from, say, how Japan looks at the problem. Which means that for us, climate change may be one of the factors, but we don't really design our policies keeping in view what might be the potential changes that might happen in the environment in the future. So the external factors are definitely adding to the problem, but from a policy response point of view, we are not recognizing it and planning for it enough. So I wanted to say something, what has been done and some experiments which are successful. Some of this is my own work, which I wanted to share. There are reforms in urban water supply that are being brought about. Many of them are like a combination or integrated reforms, because it is very difficult to have a reform only on the supply side, but not on the institutional or organizational side. So the reforms are trying to bring about decentralization, participation of the private players, giving the urban local bodies more empowerment in terms of, say, deciding tariffs and so on. Cost recovery, which remains a big problem. There are also reforms on how can they design better tariff systems such that there is more cost recovery. And one case which I wanted to share here is the case of Nagpur. It was the first citywide tender that was granted through a public-private partnership. And what was unique about it is that it was a package, meaning that it targeted several different things. So it targeted, of course, the supply side in terms of the service itself. So 24/7 service, reduction in non-revenue water, more revenues through tariffs, metering. So therefore, you know, reduced leakages and illegal connections and so on. Heavy investment in the infrastructure itself. So in the physical infrastructure itself. So it was like relaying of the pipe network, providing households with individual piped connections. And possibly the biggest game changer here was the nature of the contract. So while there were other PPP initiatives that happened, why this one was considered successful is because it was a very performance-based PPP. So the company, it was Veolia, which was the partner, was made accountable if it did not achieve certain targets. So these targets were in terms of the quality of supply, revenue collection, non-revenue water reduction, and so on. So it was a performance-based PPP, and the nature of the contract, I think, was what really made a difference compared to some other initiatives, which were just, you know, you come, you try to implement some reform and leave, and there was no accountability on the part of the partner. So this is one case where urban water reforms as a whole. So there is, again, you know, there's a political economy underlying this particular story in Nagpur as to why was it possible. It was mainly because the state government and the central government were aligned. So it was the same government, and that's what made it possible for the reform to go through so quickly and it to be implemented in the city. The other thing which is happening not in one city, but in, you know, in many urban centers is what is called the integrated urban water management. Again, it's like, you know, you can almost think of it as, you know, as a manifesto. What is it that they want to achieve? And most importantly, what it states is that it wants to take a systems approach to water management, which means that water management is not just management of water as a commodity, but we need to think of it as a resource and what is going to require to do that and to change the entire supply side, to also try to change behaviors through public engagement, other stakeholders, so involving the private sector, making sure there is coordination between different levels of government. What also was done, and I will come to a case which is of Delhi, is data collection. You know, what was very interesting for me to see is Dr. Ishii's graphs on, you know, specific, say, city level, say, groundwater measures and so on, which for us simply do not exist for such a long time horizon because we have not really invested in collecting and monitoring that kind of data. So that is being done now. You know, we have, you know, GIS systems and water resource information systems in place, which help us monitor. And this was something that Delhi did. It's been just a few years since the policy was drafted, and some aspects of it are also implemented quite actively. So what made the case unique for Delhi is that, one, it was a very forward-looking policy. So it did not just look at, say, all right, we only need to think of households and whether we can get access and also ensure that there is equity in water supply. But it also talked about water security and diversifying sources of water. It talked about stakeholder engagement to ensure that there is coordination. So another example of why it is so difficult administratively for cities in India is because, say, one aspect of water management, water supply, for instance, is, say, managed by the water board. So which in the case of Delhi is the Delhi Jal Board, which is the Delhi Water Board. But stormwater management is, you know, at the sub-administrative level within the city. So there are 11 districts, and each of those district administrative officers, they will be responsible for drafting plans for stormwater management. So they were never really integrated. And now that is what is the changed you know, dialogue and thinking, that all of this needs to be done together. It has to be a systems approach. We cannot just think of water for consumption as one problem and address that. There are all kinds of issues that need to come together. There was also emphasis on financial and organizational capacities. So it has been observed that the budget for water and sanitation in the city has been on an increasing trend. I was mentioning data management. So there is the Geospatial Delhi Limited, just one of the agencies which collects a lot of spatial data and makes it available to anyone who wants to use it at a cost. Very interesting measure by the Delhi urban local government is the district metering. They call them district metering area. So this is a data collection effort where they're saying we really need to disaggregate and understand where the problem of non-revenue water, for instance, is coming. And each of these 11 districts are therefore responsible for collecting data for their own district. Below the districts are subdivisions. So ideally, the data should exist even for those subdivisions. And I believe there are some 30-odd subdivisions. So over time, the objective is that they would have highly disintegrated data where they can precisely identify that the highest consumption and non-revenue water. So if it is consumed, are they collecting enough billable revenue? If not, which means that there is wastage, and they will be able to identify which exactly will be these districts where there is consumption, but also high wastage, and then be very targeted in their approach in the sense of how to manage water resources within more local areas. So very interesting in terms of how they're trying to address issues of non-revenue water instead of just thinking of the city as one homogeneous unit, which is quite challenging because every neighborhood is quite different. And while it might be very common for Japan to have very advanced technologies, for India even to have something like trenchless sewer technology is considered to be a step forward. So that is something that Delhi is doing as well, so that there is no requirement of manual labor intervention in, say, addressing sewage problems. Now, this is a choice of a case because, these are the kinds of cities that in the end, India has to deal with, the big metro cities. The newer smart cities, of course, are taking a very different approach. They can design and plan things from scratch. And that is being observed in places such as GIFT City, which is not very far from Ahmedabad. So they're doing things quite differently and quite well in terms of already planning for all of these things. So I'm not bringing that in because they're still very few. For us, the bigger issues still are at the metro city and other tier one, tier two city levels. So what could be the potential areas of concern? So yes, we need to do a lot. But some of the things which definitely need to be addressed on a more urgent basis, which we believe is one, public engagement. It is very surprising. And when we were doing this research in Nagpur, what was found out is many of the people didn't really care for the reform. They're like, who cares for 24/7 water? We don't need 24/7 water. We need water only, for so much time that it can help us fill up all our storage that we have already invested in. So why should now we be expected to pay more for a service which we don't really need? So people don't really understand what the long-term views of reforms are. Many people have no sense of where their main source of water is. Where is it coming from? If it is coming from 40, 50 kilometers away, a river body, they have really no understanding of that and what it means to bring water from so far into the city, to treat it, to supply it. So public engagement, and it was nice to see how it is being done in Japan, where you can actually engage, say, school children to actually see their sources of water and how they need to be managed. So that kind of an education would really help. Stormwater management, I think, is one of the most ignored areas. Even in a city like Ahmedabad, it seems pretty much missing from the city plans. So every year in a city which does not get too much rainfall, we have flooding. So that is something which stands out. Groundwater rights. What has been done in India is a lot of attention for groundwater extraction goes towards the agricultural use. So there are some good things which have been done, and in some ways groundwater extraction is sort of brought under control when it comes to agricultural use. But when it comes to urban groundwater extraction, the legal framework for that is still not very clear. So obviously it comes down to land rights. So if I have a house under which there is a, under which I can just dig a borewell and extract groundwater, there is nothing stopping me from doing that. So better regulation, of course, needs to happen around it. And as such, it is, again, you know, it's a point of contention. How do we tackle the issue of water rights and land ownership rights together? So it goes beyond just a water issue. It's really, how do we design a legal framework? And as I said, I already had examples from Japan, which Dr. Ishii already highlighted. One, the Fukuoka city, which he showed us, and the other, the Shinjuku district, which also has invested in a lot of recycling. So I won't go back to talking about those. What I will do instead is, what is it that is different between India and Japan when we think of urban water issues? Fundamentally, I think the problem definition is different, and which is why the way we design our policies for water, handling water management issues are different. So the way India is currently looking at it, and of course it has to do with the fact that, you know, we are still at a very different stage of development. So for us, it is still a lot about the consumer, the user, and it is still about access, and it is still about giving everyone an individual water connection and making sure that it is affordable and making sure that it is reliable and making sure that there is equity. So our problem definition is still very much that. And the fact that water is a resource, and we need to think of it broadly in the sense of the environment and what it means in the long term, that is still very new. That is a very new discussion in our policy framework. So while, yes, it's not that we don't, you know, give any consideration to climate change and other environmental factors, a lot of our focus is still on the consumer and tariffs and making sure that there is, as I was saying, access and equity. So when we define the problem differently, of course, our policy design is going to be very different. So the integrated urban water management is possibly the first step in that direction, where we start to think a little bit differently and also bring in aspects of conservation and also bring in aspects of stakeholder engagement and of technology and innovation. So these are still very new and nascent in our urban water policy reforms. Some of the things which are done in Japan and are quite replicable in any other context, not just India, is what they're doing in Fukuoka, which is called a payment for ecosystem service. So this is a very, it's a well-known tool, policy instrument by now, which was used to tackle deforestation in countries like, say, Brazil. And what you essentially are doing is you're compensating the users for giving, say, the state or whoever is the authority, some environmental service in return. So, for instance, if you have to encourage an entire community to make sure that they allow for water recharge and not utilize entire, you know, keep extracting groundwater, you have to provide them some kind of compensation. And there are different sort of ways in which you can design a payment for ecosystem service. And this is a very innovative approach, which we really haven't experimented with. So that would be one, say, important, very concrete lesson as to what would be those tools and instruments that we can implement. So PES, the aspect of public engagement, everyone keeps talking about recycling, and you know, that is, yes, we do that. Rainwater harvesting is not new for us, but recycling is an expensive technology. If we have to do it at scale, at a municipal level, people have to be able to willing to pay for that kind of a service. Then, are we willing to pay for it? So we then have to design our you know, tariffs and understand people's perspective towards such a policy. So some things, you know, we can do, it is possible. Some would be nice if we can do it, but that would mean that people also have to understand and respond in those manners to those policy changes. So I'll stop here and look forward to getting more comments and questions.
Thank you. Namrata, I think you have taken you started off by scaring all of us by telling us the extent of the crisis that is looming in India and Indian cities in particular. Then you quickly took us through the challenges which are faced by the Indian cities, overview of the mitigation efforts that Government of India has woken up, and the silver lining of the two case studies that you discussed, the Nagpur case study and the Delhi case study. I think that shows that change is possible, and it can probably be replicated quickly in other cities or megacities, as once the results or once the processes have been set in place in these two cities. I think you concluded by giving us some overview of success stories, or what we can learn from those success stories in Japan. I think that's a wonderful tone setting. So if I may ask Professor Namrata, since you have been brought this up now, that the challenges of managing the urban water resources is becoming complex, and as you rightly said. And the problem is only going to become worse because of the surge in the urban growth pattern. What Professor Ishii had talked about, that it had peaked in 60s, but in Japan it has been coming down, but I think in India it's a long way away from peaking. So in the light of this, can you provide an insight about the other challenges from rapid urbanization and the impact on the urban water? You did hint at it, but if you can clarify that, plus highlight any factors that need to be addressed in order to establish a more sustainable and efficient water management plan.
So if I understand correctly, what are the other, besides the three that I highlighted, what are the other challenges in the context of urban water? And in terms of addressing, what could be some of the recommendations? Is that sort of broadly the question? I mean, if we have to really think of the problem beyond just say a demand and supply issue, so obviously, you know, problems on both sides exist. So from a demand side, we really haven't, and I'm generalizing here, not all cities necessarily function like that, but our tariffs are definitely not optimal. There is a reluctance to even, you know, change the design of our tariffs because it is so sensitive for the consumers. Therefore, I think whatever is done around demand and demand control is, you know, you try to control it in some other way. So either you say that, okay, you know, you, if you are in a place where it's a new construction, then you absolutely have to invest in a rainwater harvesting system, and that's a building code requirement. So those are fine. I mean, all of those things are fine to do. But I think all the related issues around urbanization need to be addressed because they directly impinge on urban water usage. Groundwater extraction, which I already highlighted, really needs to be, in some way, there has to be a regulation around that in the context of cities. So while, as I was saying, for agricultural purposes, some good policy design has been happening, for urban water, not so much. And some of the things actually might be very low-hanging fruit, which is just, you know, behavioral changes. And we are not really investing a whole lot in bringing about those. So for us, it is, you know, we are still dealing with such fundamental issues of access to water and water rights. And we are, you know, we are not really able to see there is a much bigger picture around how we can bring about urban water reform. So while there are these hard instruments like regulations, there could be more acceptable policy instruments like, let's just invest a little bit in behavior change. And there are enough now in the literature, there exists enough evidence where, say, simple things like giving people information on their water bills about how they compare. So how do you compare in terms of your neighborhood level consumption? And putting that on your water bill. And this has been done even in the context of Indian cities. So very, very simple behavioral interventions can also be quite effective. So there you don't need to, you know, come with a stick approach that, okay, now we're just going to come and regulate, which always, you know, legal frameworks are always more complicated. And awareness and behavior change might be another route to take. And that is something which even the Indian government is investing in. So that is part of other sort of series of studies which, say, me and the School of Public Policy here at IMA, we are doing. So it's called the Lifestyle for Environment Initiative. And Niti Aayog, and of course the government as a whole, is leading that effort. And under that, there is law. There is water conservation, there is waste management, a lot of these things. And they're, of course, integrated as well. And their emphasis is on simple behavioral interventions, but which can bring about a big change. So it might seem as if, oh, it is such a, you know, simple thing. But really, you know, people are not aware. People are not aware where their water is coming from. People are not aware how a filtration system works and how much it costs. Like for one, you know, 1 liter of clean drinking water, what is the cost of getting that to their household water tap? Just providing them, making this information more salient, you know, might be something which is a lot more impactful than coming with very heavy-handed approaches. So these are some of the things which can be tried and experimented with, besides the bigger issues which I already highlighted. And it is coming in slowly. So with the new thinking in, say, Niti Aayog, these things are slowly entering the mainstream policy dialogue as well.
But what is your the follow-up question on what you just said? There are some states, you mentioned Delhi, but Delhi also gives water as a freebie.
Yes.
You mentioned that price tariff is a very sensitive issue. Is there any example where any state in which it is implemented well?
So the other case of Nagpur, I would go back to that. So what happened there is because it was like a package reform, there was really no choice. You know, you were going to be metered whether you like it or not. And I mentioned it during my presentation that the political conditions were very specific.
Okay.
The central government was BJP, the state government was BJP. A lot of the municipal corporation elections, a lot of the wards had, you know, BJP corporators. And that reform was really possible because of this alignment. For many years, the city tried, and it was all over the press. So even after being implemented, it got a lot of bad press. But they still went away, went ahead with implementing it once it was possible for them to do so. Once the central government aligned, so it started only 2014 onwards.
Oh.
So that was, say, around the time when, you know, finally Gadkari and all of those people, they could make it happen. And with that, although people were still unhappy, like, why are you, you know, some of them said, why are you imposing this on us? But when we went there, say, a year later, and some of the people had already started receiving water supply under those new metered connections. And they said, yes, you know, the definitely the quality of water is better. There is more reliability. So it was also sort of just experiencing the reform in many ways. So while there was a lot of reluctance and maybe still continues to be in certain sections of the society, but eventually once I guess people get used to better services, maybe we will see that their perception towards willingness to pay for better services will also change. So yeah, I mean, there is a comment that it had better local government. Yeah, so that is there, but it was still only after the actual alignment that it was possible, because water still remains a state subject. So it still has to pass through it. So while the implementation at the local level, for sure, you know, the same administrative capacity may not exist in some other city, and which is also attributed to the success of that particular reform. But to even bring about the reform was possible because of certain the political factors coming together. So that would be another way that you, you know, it's not the best way to put it, and I have no other way to say it, but all right, you arm twist and then you know, wait and watch whether people accept better services or not. And we are seeing this in other areas as well. We are seeing this in energy reforms. Right. So it's not like, you know, people choose to get electricity. Yes, of course, for your household connection, you can still make a choice. But once a reform is implemented at, you know, at the DISCOM level, and you start getting better electricity supply, and Gujarat is an example of that, you know, people will say, yes, you know, we are willing to pay for it. You know, this is a game changer for us in terms of the way we are able to live now. So that would be, yeah, that would be my thought.
Thank you. I think you have hit the nail on its head. The next question, of course, Dr. Ishii, I just want to ask the previous question that Dr. Namrata had answered in the Indian context about imposing tariffs and as a policy method to control the usage of water. And she also mentioned that in India, it's a very sensitive issue and a lot of resistance. What has been the Japan's experience in this regard?
Water tariff, yes, it's a political issue in Japan also. So local parliament, assembly, can approve it. It's local assembly members always it's always concern about their residence or constitution's residence. Yeah. So yeah, definitely it's a political issue in Japan also, and it's quite difficult to raise tariffs. Even nowadays, well, every price is rising, electricity, anything. But even under such situation, local assembly, it's not easily accept raising tariffs, and mayors also. So yeah, definitely this is a political issue. However, yeah, some intervention from central government can intervene somehow, can guide or can recommend to local municipality. So I understand the Indian central government or state government, they also have some sort of a status, even though they are influenced by political affairs. But such a government ministries can make influence on local government, such a policies. It's a very similar to Japan. So how to such a strong government can, how to say, not necessarily intervene, but how to move or how to push a local government? This would be some sort of a solution, I feel.
Thank you. I think it is good to know that people or politics, both in Japan and India, are not very dissimilar. And but I have another question for you, Dr. Ishii. This is regarding you mentioned about the climate change and the unpredictable nature of climate patterns. It is rapidly changing, and some say it is non-linear effect, and it can pose substantial challenges for ensuring reliable and sustainable water. So, in what would be your view on what Japan is trying to address? Because this is slightly futuristic. It is not today. It could be maybe tomorrow or the day after. So how does this be taken into account by the planners in Japan?
Yeah, okay. Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much for a very important point. I think I want to list two areas. First one is scientific knowledge. It's well, we don't know, but we don't know future. Even though some scientific knowledge can use for projection or prediction. In case of Japan, luckily we are smaller countries than India, much smaller. That's why recently the government predict future change of rainfall patterns, and throughout the country. Not so different. The impact is very unified. So they say rainfall will increase by 20% on average throughout the country. And the flood volume will increase by 40%. And the chance of flooding will increase double. So we can use such a scientific knowledge for prediction. I believe in India, well, I believe at the state level, they can predict future such a rainfall pattern change. So based on such a scientific knowledge, we can know somehow future, even though there are some uncertainty, of course, but we can predict some future. And this is number one. And the second thing is countermeasures, adaptation. Climate is changing, rainfall is increasing. In such case, structural measures alone cannot protect our society. So rainfall, flood volume is increasing, or can we continue constructing dikes forever? We cannot. So that's why, as already Professor Namarata pointed out, such a planning, urban planning or land use regulation, or some measures in outside rivers. These are quite important. So the conventional approach is the constructing dikes or dams in river. It's fundamentally important, but not enough. We should consider such an increasing risk and how to manage such increasing risk. Not only in riverside, but also outside urban areas also. Yeah, this is my thought.
Thank you. I think that is a very insightful discussion. I will ask one, of course, both of you did mention, both Dr. Namrata and Dr. Ishii, about the managing of these water resources, identifying the factors should help. But what are the factors which could act as a barrier for effective implementation? You did hint about the politics part of it. I'm addressing Dr. Namrata. You also hinted about non-coordination between various agencies. So other than these two or three, what could in your opinion, be other major barriers which will are preventing currently urban water resource management?
So in the context of India, so again, I think I touched upon them already, so nothing probably new to what I already mentioned. So we need to really break down the different sort of policy capacity issues. And one of the biggest capacity issues for municipal corporations is, in general, they are not generating enough revenue for themselves. Many state governments are saying that, you know, essentially municipal corporations should learn to become sustainable financially. And unless that happens, a lot of the investment that needs to happen from the urban governance bodies side then may not happen. So I'm not just talking big city municipal corporations, but other urban local governance bodies as well. And the problem is the same. So it's only a few, of course, you know, very rich municipal corporations, but even there, the other, you know, issues, even if they manage to be financially sustainable, if you go, say, to the city of Mumbai, I mean, they have a serious problem of flooding and lack of like a proper sewage management system. And all of that then needs to come into the city planning discussions. So the policy capacity issues then also exist at that level. So there is the financial, there is just sort of the knowledge and the expertise. Who is it that is in the policy design or decision-making team? And a very important point, which was just mentioned by Dr. Ishii, is scientific knowledge, right? How many of our policymakers are actually willing to listen to people who present them with scientific knowledge? And how seriously do they take that in designing policies and taking a very futuristic view? Also, there is now an entire field in public policy, which is essentially just futures thinking, you know, teaching our policymakers and, of course, even say people like myself who study public policy to incorporate like scenarios when we talk about what could be the potential scenario and are we prepared to handle that kind of a scenario. So you know, there is financial, there is the just operational, organizational, the knowledge and the willingness to engage with, say, you know, the experts and other stakeholders. So a lot of these are the barriers. And essentially academia and policy in India don't see eye to eye. So you know, that shouldn't be the case. We need to listen to our, you know, engineers and our environment scientists and so on, and to see how all of that knowledge can come together in better policy design.
Very nice. In fact, I would like to ask this question to Dr. Ishii. You heard Dr. Namrata. Could be, I don't know whether you still face these same challenges which he mentioned, or you have been able to address them, but you are facing some other challenge.
Yeah, yes, I think I want to point out two areas. First one is silos. Yeah, oh. India and Japan have very strong ministries or organizations, bureaucrats, I said. It's good. Yeah. They can lead and they can intervene. But in some cases, water ministry is very strong and urban water supply ministry is also strong. And well, not so easy to work together. Well, in case of Japan, it's the same. So this is the one area. So integration, integrating, integrated policy is crucial. However, to work together among strong ministries, well, this is not easy. In case of Japan, Prime Minister leads, I mean, Prime Minister offices or cabinet offices, such a supervising office of the government, establish some office or committee, and they can try to manage. This is one way. Or if there is one big ministry is there. In case of Japan, it's a Ministry of Infrastructure. Ministry of Infrastructure can coordinate as a ministry. This is another way. Well, anyway, silo is a crucial issue. And second thing is a practical approach. Yeah, of course, practical approach is important, but how to judge it is practical? This is challenge, I think. Yeah, we can say, well, we can stop or we can ban usage of using groundwater. Well, it's true, it's logically correct, but we have to consider practical issues. If we ban farmers or industries, where they can get water? And what's the reaction? So we need some good communication with such users. Well, this is point also pointed out by Professor Namakwa. Yeah, such a communication, based on communication, we can examine, is this a practical policy or is this a practical approach? Then we can implement. In case of Japan, actually, Japanese government, they know they can regulate groundwater. However, they didn't, because they knew also this is only water source for private sector. So it took some years to start such a policy after they could secure water resources, another water resources, then they could start regulation. So such a practical approach, taking such a practical approach is a challenge or barrier.
Good. I think that has been very open and clear summary the barriers that Japan is even currently facing. And I think we also have it maybe on a slightly bigger scale. Dr. Namrata, there is one question from the audience that Chennai many times as a city has been highlighted as a city which does a good rainwater harvest. Is a case study or considered as a success model. As per you, because you have an overview of all the major cities, are there any other cities or mega cities in India that have similarly done a good job in rain harvesting?
So as I was mentioning, I think now in the newer building codes, it is coming in as a requirement that some of these systems need to be in place. So I would say pretty much you would see wherever there are new developments, this would be there by default. Some of them are going a step forward and even investing in things like reverse osmosis systems right in the premises. Where people are able to do this, or if it is a requirement as part of building codes, it will certainly happen. And now it is not happening in pockets. I think the bigger point is, even though there is rainwater harvesting happening or it is becoming a requirement for new developments, as a proportion of overall water requirement, it is still very small. Majority of lot of the household water requirements will still come either from wherever the main, say, the river or a reservoir resource is, and second would be groundwater. So as a proportion in the entire sort of water usage mix, it is not making that big a dent that it should, really significantly bring about a change in other utilization of other resources. For that, I think we simply need to diversify at scale, not at individual household. That will require, something what Dr. Ishii was showing us, at like a big stadium level and multiple of those kinds of investments. So the capital investment at scale to really make a dent such that it becomes a major proportion in the overall water usage mix is required.
Okay, wonderful point. Roughly what percentage is rainwater harvest?
I Yeah, I wouldn't be able to quote for sure because these tend to be very city-specific numbers. I would not peg it beyond, say, 2 to 5%. That too, again, like I'm saying, very city-specific. Again, it is for very specific purposes. Same, in fact, is the case even for things like recycled water in developed countries. Like in the sense of their overall water mix, it does not tend to be more than 10-15% or so. They still depend heavily on getting water from, say, fresh water, rivers, reservoirs, and so on. So these are very, very heavy investments, capital investments, but how much do they change the water usage mix is something we need to think about. So yeah, I think still a long way to go in terms of it becoming a major source.
Dr. Ishii, there's a question from the audience. When you use groundwater, because you did talk about the effect of overusage of groundwater, sinking of the ground, etc. So is there any difference in tariff between usage of groundwater versus usage of rainwater or other sources of water in Japanese tariff system? Do you differentiate between these two, or is there no difference?
If some private companies take water from river, they have to pay water rights tariff to prefecture governments. However, they don't need to pay money tariff for groundwater.
Oh, okay.
It's their asset, and of course, it's regulated, but it's an asset, so they can use under some regulation.
Yeah, same is the case in India. It's linked with land rights. Right. So you're only paying for the investment that you make for extraction, so for the borewell digging and all. But once you do that, you can extract as much without paying any additional. So the marginal cost of extraction is very low. That's what needs to change.
Right. That is the regulation you talked about. Yeah. Dr. Ishii, there is one question not directly linked with that would be the last question for today. Not linked with the subject, but linked with your focus area, which is disaster management. And we all know about the tsunami, its effect on Fukushima's reactor. So since then, what has been the measures that Japan as a nation has taken with regard to tsunami and mitigating the effects of tsunami?
Yeah, thank you very much. So, mainly two measures. The most important measure is relocation. So from all tsunami risk areas, houses were relocated to safer upper ground, and the risk areas were activities nowadays are prohibited. Anyone cannot construct houses there in this area. And this is one measure. And secondly, government constructed dikes along my coast. And however, they gave up to protect all tsunamis. It's very costly, and the tsunami wall must be very high. So it's unrealistic. And so they targeted only a certain level of a tsunami. It's once in 100 years. Tohoku tsunami was once in 1,000 years. So they gave up to protect Tohoku tsunami same scale. Instead, frequent tsunami against, they constructed dikes. And so these are measures. First one is relocation. No one lives here. And second one, such as concrete walls what she was. Almost these works completed almost over 90% or something. Yeah, after how many years? Already 12 years, yes.
Great. Thank you. Really appreciate. Of course, there are many other questions we could have explored. We wanted to explore, but time is a constraint. And I truly appreciate your participation, both of you. We really hope that we will be able to use you as resources, continue to use you as resources to spread the knowledge about this important area through our MIJSC. And again, thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you so much
for inviting me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ishii. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.